Christos Stoikouros for Greece before turning to Spain.
Thank you, President. Last July, a historic milestone has been achieved in the field of international taxation. The statement on a new framework for international tax reform is the response required to the challenges of the globalized and digitalized economy. Greece has consistently supported a global agreement throughout the discussion at the international fora, since we firmly believe in a global, consensus-based solution apt to the requirements of the modern world. Accordingly, we have joined the consensus on the key elements of a two-pillar international tax architecture and look forward for the finalization of the remaining issues and the implementation, hopefully joined by all-inclusive framework members. The July statement expresses the country's determination for the new agreements on Pillar 1 and Pillar 2 to take full effect as soon as 2023. The question I would like to raise is the following one. A major incentive for joining the agreement and suppressing national digital service taxes is fiscal, is that Pillar 1 will generate substantial revenues for the countries. Based on the data available to OECD, will Pillar 1 generate enough revenues to convince jurisdictions' long-term commitment by the agreement? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chris.
Thank you, Brazil. And now I give the floor to Greece.
Thank you, Pierre. We support the development of common international standards on taxonomies that promote consistency and interoperability with the European Union standards. Harmonized taxonomies of green and sustainable economic activities can shed light on financial flows, counter greenwashing, and mobilize sustainable investment by setting out clear classifications. We believe that attention should also turn to international convergence in clearly defining brown and transition activities. Rapid consolidation at the global level is a pressing priority if financial markets are to respond effectively to the risks and opportunities arising from climate change and other sustainability factors. We recognize several dimensions need to be specified when designing a harmonized global framework, such as materiality perspectives, metrics, or governance. In this respect, securing the coherence and reliability of metrics is instrumental for ensuring both the fast and effective adoption of all market participants and for reaching our climate goals. We support the double materiality principle currently under discussion in the EU context. Tailoring for different types of firms, including different types of financial institutions, is likely to elevate the quality and degree of comparability of reporting and enable quicker progress. In this respect, consolidation of reporting frameworks may build upon voluntary ESG disclosure frameworks. Comprehensive and widespread ESG disclosure by financial institutions and corporates will require multiple efforts to build capacity, develop tools, and consensus on approaches and expectations, which means that a close international dialogue between policymakers will be required to ensure that a harmonized framework is reflected in regulatory and policy instruments. Thank you, Pierre.
Thank you very much, and now I give the floor to France.
Thank you, President. We recognize the importance of preferential trade agreements and the key role of the WTO in promoting fair labor market standards. Competition and labor rights must go hand in hand. We believe that policymakers have a responsibility to enforce freedom of association and fair labor standards in line with ILO relevant international conventions. To this effect, international trade must be conducted with a rules-based framework, promoting fair competition and respecting labor and all other non-negotiable rights. The priority of governments should be to make trade work for all, ensuring that all relevant rules are globally adhered to. Subsidies and support to state-owned enterprises should not result into market distortions, and their use should always be subject to ensuring a level playing field in the area of international trade.
Very importantly, they should also be made contingent on observing the minimum ILO standards. OECD can provide data and analysis informing governments regarding the status quo in the fields I just mentioned and can help towards formulating relevant policies. In this way, the OECD can enhance transparency and accountability and promote the application of its recommendations on competitive neutrality, also drawing on the work of national competition authorities. Finally, OECD can also make an important contribution towards safeguarding the application of international labour standards, ensuring that they are not compromised in the interest of competitiveness. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Austria.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Before I go into